Indianapolis Fire Department has come a long way since it was first established way back in 1859. The diversification of today's fire service offers a challenging yet rewarding career to all those who are up to pursuing it. But to understand the tradition of excellence that one comes to expect from today's fire department, one only needs to travel back in time a little ways when fires are put out in a much more primitive fashion. The history of firefighting in Indianapolis began in 1821, soon after the city was settled. Early residents took measures for protecting their log cabins and rough board houses from fire. This bucket and ladder operation saw its first mechanical hand engine for extinguishing fires in 1835. Local villagers gazed upon the new contraption in utter amazement. That bucket and ladder group of 1821 became the Marion Fire Company. By 1849, the city was protected by volunteer fire companies. It was a mark of social recognition to belong to one of these companies. In many ways, these volunteer companies were like fraternities. The loyalty of a volunteer to his particular company was so intense that it can hardly be comprehended today. The rivalry of getting first water on a fire led to a series of fires that carried dismay to property owners and filled insurance men with alarm. It is said that rival companies would set places on fire so they could be the first to put them out. Bragging rights for the number of fires extinguished in Indianapolis was quite important to these various volunteer companies. Likewise, the vanquished companies felt bound by duty to regain their reputation at the earliest date possible. So, as a result, one fire followed another in quick succession. The volunteer fire companies of Indianapolis had become their own arsonists. The old volunteer system passed away to be succeeded by the more orderly and businesslike methods of the paid fire department. It was by an act of city council that it was decided that the haphazard ways of the old volunteer system wasn't cutting it, and what we now know as the Indianapolis Fire Department became established. The first fire chief was Joseph Davis, and he received a salary of $300 a year. By 1869, the department consisted of 3 steam engines, 8 fire hose wagons, 40 firemen, and 14 horses. The old fire stations had bell towers in them. These bells were sounded to alert all those concerned within earshot of the station that a fire was occurring. Most of these older firehouses were built just before or shortly after the turn of the century. The character that lives on in the tradition in today's fire department can be seen in the faces of those firemen and their machinery of yesteryear. Thank you. 13 firefighters were killed and many more injured in the Bow and Merrill Publishing House fire that was located one block from Monument Circle near Meridian and Washington Streets. The fire, seen here, was a raging inferno that the department fought for 2 days. Following this, a relief committee collected over $53,000 to aid families of the dead. The Fireman's Fund was quickly established as a result of this devastating fire. The Bow and Merrill fire remains today as the worst toll among the department in the city's history. The purpose of the Fireman's Fund was to provide payments to disabled firemen or their families in the event of death. The early 1900s had their share of spectacular fires that included blazes at the Capital Paper Company, Griff Brothers, the Stuart Carey Glass Company, and the Methodist Church at Meridian and New York Street. Getting to those fires back then looked more like the Kentucky Derby than what we have become accustomed to seeing today. But as one can see, they probably made up for any lost time with their unbridled energy and enthusiasm to put out the fire. There is an undeniable romanticism that surrounds this profession as we look back on it. It beckoned to the adventurism in the hearts of men, young and old alike. Little wonder why firefighting was so alluring to many in the 18 and early 1900s. In the mid-1800s, the department had a number of stations or companies, and those companies had their own names, for identity was still very important in the fraternal sense back then. There was the Marions, the Independent Relief Company, the Invincibles, which was largely composed of Germans, and they were also known as the Wooden Shoes to other companies, though they didn't care for that name very much. And in turn, the Invincibles called the Relief Company the Shanghais. The Southside Company was known as the Spirit of 76, and the Western Liberties were on the west side, naturally, and the last company were the Rovers, located on Indiana Avenue. After years of tradition and service, today's Indianapolis Fire Department consists of 30 fire stations that house emergency response vehicles that will make more than 30,000 runs in a year, with a response time of 2.5 minutes, which is tops in the United States. Always progressive, today's department has minorities in leadership roles like never before. More women serve in fire service, and the dedication of Fire Chief Joseph Kimbrew can be easily seen by his more than 33 years on the department without a sick day. Now that's dedication.
Some of the big things that I see as strides forward in the fire department that I have seen is, while our communications system leaves something to be desired, it's much, much better than it was 33 years ago. Also, the equipment that we work with, our clothing, as far as safety is concerned, is much, much better. The modern technology, the different types of nozzles, for instance, the incident command system, that, you know, you can go on and on.
Rick, many of the changes that I have seen in the fire service and expect to see in the future relate to the technology that is being used in the fire service and the education. The safety aspects have been enhanced greatly over my 20 years on the fire department.
You know, the famous cat, will you come and get my cat out of the tree? Believe it or not, there's probably a call a day every day of the year that comes in here that they want to know if the fire department will either get their cat out of the tree, get the raccoon out of the chimney, pump out the basement that's full of water, will you help us put up a flagpole rope because we've not got a ladder to reach it. And although people perceive those as a public service, we don't do those. Years ago, I'm going back at least a dozen years, maybe longer than that, that's part of that macho image we talked about earlier that firemen did because they didn't have anything else to do. Today, that's not the case.
I guess some of the most significant changes in Indianapolis in the last few years, and more especially in the last 2.5 that I've been the chief of fire prevention, is our landscape. You know, we have a 50-story building going up. Already this year, we've had 2 30-story buildings go up. Prior to that, construction was just not that intensified, I guess would be a good word. Every day, you're going to see more and more high-rises go up in our city. And I think that changes the challenges of the fire service, changes the challenges of our community through getting all these people in one little building and having the systems in place. And again, that's what we have to stay on top of. The mayor sent me a memo several months ago asking could we have a fire as they did in L.A. Well, in reality we could, because in the 60s and 70s buildings did not have to be sprinklered. And in the downtown area alone we have 60% of the buildings that are not sprinklered, nor did they have to be. But today's new buildings, the 30-story and the 50-story skyscrapers that you see going up, and they're not going to stop, they're going to increase. They have the best technology, the best systems. They're safer than most people's homes.
In 1988, the Indianapolis City County Council passed an ordinance requiring all dwellings in Marion County to have smoke detectors installed. But smoke detectors are not going to help a single bit unless the batteries in them are not checked periodically. And for this home with this smoke detector, having the batteries checked would have been a big help.
They are proven lifesavers. We see it every day. And it's my deep concern that enough people still don't have them. The ordinance is in place. I think it takes effect around the first of the year. I don't yet know how it can be fully enforced, but I don't think too much emphasis can be put on smoke alarms.
We will come out and install a smoke detector free because the business community has donated smoke detectors to us. They look like this. They're very simple to install. The ones that we have are battery operated. Battery sits in the back. Again, the sound we're looking to hear is that they save lives. We recommend that everyone have one. And again, effective March of 1989, it does become law.
Many homes would go in and after the cleanup is done after the fire, they'll have a smoke alarm and they won't have a battery even in it. They just don't work very well without the batteries in them. That's something, assign someone in your family that job, that bi-weekly or monthly or whatever you decide, I would say at least monthly, assign that person that your job is to check the batteries in the smoke detector. Another a person's job can be to check that the fire extinguisher is charged if you have one in your home, which you should. And that way it's not a burden on anybody. You can rotate those responsibilities, but they must be charged and have the batteries in them, or they're just no good. They're just a piece of plastic hanging on the ceiling or wall. So.
Attacking a fire is a lot more than just dousing flames with water. There is a lot of planning and strategy involved, as Deputy Chief David Greider explains.
Strategy and tactics are a big part of firefighting. Chief level officers, that is their main concern. And probably the primary decision that has to be made or has to be constantly updated is whether you want an aggressive, offensive, interior attack or a defensive, exterior attack. Our firefighters are very, very aggressive. They've been trained to make an aggressive interior attack, but it's the chief officer's job, mine and the division chiefs and district chiefs under me, to determine whether the situation is stable enough to allow an aggressive interior attack. And if that's not the case, you go to a defensive mode or an exterior attack where you lob water from outside in. Our firefighters don't like to do that. It's frustrating. But there is no benefit to going in a vacant building and potentially losing or injuring many firefighters when the building isn't going to be worth anything if we save it. So there again, we try to consider the risk-benefit ratio, whether we're going to make an aggressive interior attack or a defensive stand back and throw water on it. We try to use a risk-benefit ratio before we advance into an area. And the Marat is a new, well-kept building, or not, it's an old building, but it is well-kept, has a high dollar loss, so we made an aggressive interior attack. That attack put the fire out initially, and shortly after the fire was extinguished, our firefighters were trapped. And many firefighters asked me, do you think our aggressive attack got us hurt? I think an aggressive interior attack probably saved the lives of one or more firefighters, because the fire was extinguished for all intent and purposes before they were trapped. The frustrating thing of that fire was they were trapped for about an hour or more, and we had to slowly, very tediously work to get those firefighters out. If you try to hurry an operation like that, there was approximately 1 to 2 tons of material. The load can shift, and we could have done more damage by trying to hurry. So we stabilized the firefighters that were trapped and worked and deliberately to extricate them.
Keep the temperature down a little bit.
Should help.
Hopefully. Chief, I need a truck crew with a 35-foot ladder. Get this middle house here on the west side of the fire.
The people that own that place, they ought to be run out of Indianapolis. This is why my dad's house in front of him has been destroyed, because the battery box is stored over there 25 feet from his house. Flammable toxic material, buddy. The kids is on fire once every year whenever they get too much production, I think.
The chief hazards in firefighting primarily would be heat and toxic gases would be the two major elements that you're concerned about. Your ability to assess the structures, the building structures, the extent of the fire before your arrival usually allows you to make judgments which reduce the risk that are involved in the firefighting. It is possible to be caught and to have collapses that occur catastrophically that you're not able to anticipate. Also, you're able to minimize the risk that you have with the inhalation of toxic gases through the use of breathing apparatuses, which are supplied for all firefighters now. One element that you're not able to overcome very successfully, though, is the heat. And the heat has a very telling effect on your overall cardiovascular system and your stamina, particularly when you're in an environment which may be upwards in the 300 to 500 degree range. You still can have burns if you have any exposed tissue at all. And just the heat buildup in your body and your inability to release that heat and the high humidity that you're working in is very, very stressful.
We're getting further and further involved in emergency medical care, and our run load is increasing. I think to handle the daily stresses of taking 15 to 20, 21 runs, Rescue 7 had 21 runs in a 24-hour period and had 7 runs after midnight at night. So it's very stressful, and I think that's probably the hardest thing for a firefighter. You might think it's entering a burning building. Most firefighters enjoy doing the work. When I was in the company, I enjoyed doing that type of work. It's the stress of getting up and down and catching so many runs and dealing with the emotional aspects of emergency medical care, and just the ongoing kind of a buzzword in the fire service is burnout. And you get emotionally burnt out. It can happen in other jobs, but it happens in this job due to the physical and emotional stresses combined.
The Indianapolis Fire Department is responsible for a lot more than just fighting fires. Under its jurisdiction, the department is responsible for areas of arson, emergency medical service, and hazardous materials, just to name a few. Today's fire department probably shatters the image that most of us have of it.
IFD, other than fires, IFD responds to a great deal more variety to emergencies. In other words, naturally, we're a fire department. We respond to fire alarms. We are also a medical service. We respond to medical emergencies, and that includes vehicle accidents where extrication is involved, where somebody's trapped inside a vehicle. We have the ability with heavy rescue equipment and apparatus that we can get you out in a matter of seconds in some cases. IFD also has trained dive rescue teams for water-related accidents like boating accidents or swimming accidents. We have rescue divers. Now, that's not your normal scuba dive team. That they are trained by the U.S. Coast Guard as rescue divers. We have that capability. We have the capability of hazardous material response. Now, hazardous material is any substance which can cause bodily harm. Now, that goes anywhere from battery acid to radiation.
We have rescued people off the Indiana National Bank Tower, and we feel our rope rescue team is vital in the rescue of a firefighter in a situation that a firefighter might be trapped or injured or fall.
We respond anywhere with our scuba dive team in the city, but in addition to that, any other agency outside the city in the county has but to ask. We're very proud of that. That team, they receive training from a nationally known person in that field from Colorado, I believe, and then we had the most knowledgeable person in our immediate area also involved in the training.
The fire department has come a long way over the years that has seen a number of women join recently. Breaking into a normally all-male profession was a challenge that Mary Kay Pitts was ready to tackle.
As far as applying for the department and being a woman, I see nothing to discourage a woman from applying. As long as she's physically fit and can pass the agility test that we take when we come on, the PFE, the physical fitness evaluation, I don't see any problems with it. The job's a great job. It's and if you, especially if you like physical fitness, if you like testing your limits and seeing how far you can go, that's one of the great things about this job, because I had a job that was rewarding. It was a public service job, but I wanted more, and it had to do with the fact that I enjoyed physical fitness. And this job, because you have to work out every day, and you know that if you don't keep in shape, you're going to be in trouble. And that's one of the good things about this job. It keeps you in shape. It makes you stay in shape. But I don't see any reason why a woman shouldn't apply for the job. If she has a good sense of humor and can put up with a little, nagging at her and things like that, no problem. It's a good job.
For those who qualify and are ready to accept the challenge, today's fire service offers anyone a rewarding career that is full of benefits.
The fire department has a tremendous number of benefits. The salaries have improved significantly over the years, the past few years. We offer things like the wellness program, which gives you a comprehensive medical examination, psychotherapy if you happen to need it, nutritional guidance, and guidance about how to keep yourself more physically fit. There's a very good pension program. A firefighter who works for 20 years as a firefighter can retire and be eligible at age 55 to collect 50% of a firefighter's salary for the rest of his or her life. So basic qualifications that a person has to meet when they appear at the personnel branch are that they have to have a valid Indiana driver's license, they have to be between 21 and 36 years of age, they have to be a U.S. citizen, they have to be generally in good health, and they have to have a high school education. If you meet those basic qualifications, you can begin to compete in our selection process, and over a period of months, we screen the candidates and select our recruit class from that group.
The most gratifying part of the job for me is the opportunity to help people. Every day that I come in here, I can meet a different person with a different lifestyle, a different way of doing things. You never know what's going to happen, and that keeps the job fresh, it keeps it new, and every time we go out that door, we're going to help somebody. You know, we're not going to hurt anybody or do something to hurt them. Every time we roll, we're going to help somebody, and that's real rewarding for me. I think I have the best job in the world.
I think the most difficult time and the most challenging time in my career as a firefighter has been to see, and it's kind of a negative connotation, but to see people that have died in a fire. And it's the most traumatic time, and especially when you see children, to think that you have to just go right on, you know, and you become hardened somewhat. In my history on the fire service, I've seen several people die in fire, and I think that's why I'm so dedicated to the future, to not let the younger people see the same things, to try to change the course of the fire service in that direction, where we don't have to see that any longer.